Welcome. In this video, we are learning how forms are created using Drupal's Form API. This video will give us just enough foundational knowledge to begin programming the forms in upcoming videos. Just so we have a shared understanding of the term form in the Drupal context, a Drupal form encompasses essentially three components executed in a sequential process. First, Drupal provides the actual HTML form that is displayed in the user's browser for collecting their input. The second part of a Drupal form is to validate the user-entered data. So, for example, if a form displays an email address element for input, we can have the validation component make sure that the user-supplied data seems like a properly formatted email address. If it doesn't seem like the data is valid, Drupal presents an error message until the user provides valid data. If the data does seem valid, we go to the final component. The third component of a Drupal form handles the submission of the form by determining the logic of what happens on the server to process the user input data. There are two forms that the RSVP list module needs to handle. One form, to collect the RSVP details of visitors, such as an email address, and the other form allows Drupal administrators to configure which content types have RSVP list functionality available. There are a couple areas to think through when you're creating a form. First, how does Drupal locate a form in our module's code, validate it on submission, and process the submitted data? Second, how do you define the form itself, including its fields, widgets, user-facing text, etc.? Handling these tasks is simplified by the Drupal Form API. The Drupal Form API provides a framework for building forms in Drupal. It's an abstraction layer around standard HTML forms and their handling. The purpose of Drupal's Form API is to achieve consistency in form processing and presentation while reducing the amount of HTML that must be explicitly generated by a module. The API controls the lifecycle of a form, including form definition, form display, data validation, and form submission. The Form API also provides helper utilities to make it easier to handle the HTTP post data, and by leveraging Drupal's broader utility functions, you can sanitize user input, handle transliteration, and more. If you have manually created forms in HTML before, you know that there is laborious amounts of coding involved because there is so much redundancy in the HTML code of the form. Good news! Drupal's Form API has all the HTML form elements and form-related functionality you may need already predefined, so you can use elements as needed. For instance, submit buttons, check boxes, select list, text fields, date fields, search fields, and more. Having these elements ready to go makes form building much less time-consuming. Essentially, forms are described with multi-dimensional arrays, that is, an array of arrays. This associative array structure defines all the details letting Drupal know how a form should be rendered. In fact, Drupal form arrays are leveraging render arrays. Let's learn a bit more about render arrays. Amazing attention from you so far. Render arrays are the building blocks of a Drupal page. A render array is an associative array which conforms to the standards and data structures used in Drupal's render API. The render API is integrated with the theme API, and a full understanding of the render API is not required for our purposes of module development. Case in point, in fact, we have already used render arrays. When we developed the first controller of my module back in Unit 2 of this course, in two different places, we returned an array with the keys of hashtag type and hashtag markup. Those were render arrays. With forms, beyond using the hashtag markup element, you could instead use one of the form elements available from the form render elements. These could include checkboxes, select lists, text fields, buttons, and many other elements. You can find the full list of elements at the link provided here and the resources at the end of this video. I encourage you to pause the video now and to experience the scope of form elements available. Now, just a quick note of difference. Although render arrays and arrays used by Form API do share elements, properties, and structure, many properties on form elements only have meaning for the Form API, not for the render API. What this note means practically is that you need to declare your form arrays in the correct place in code, or they do not have meaning to other systems. We'll soon gain more understanding about this specifically. There are three types of forms commonly used in Drupal. Each type has a base class for you to extend in your own custom module. First is form base. This is the most generic base class for generating forms. In fact, the other two form types extend this form base class. Next is config form base. Like the site information form found at admin/config/system/site-information, this is for creating system configuration forms. The third form type is confirm form base, which provides users with a form to confirm an action, such as deleting a piece of content. Take a moment and try to determine the types of forms we will be extending in our RSVP list module. Remember, one form needs to collect the RSVP details of visitors. The other form allows Drupal administrators to configure which content types have RSVP list functionality available. After you ponder for a bit, I'll pick back up again with the solution. Okay, the form to collect the RSVP details of visitors should use form base, as it is a generic form. The other form for Drupal administrators should use config form base, because it is a configuration form. If you determine those types correctly on your own, well done. One final thing to realize with form building is that with each of the form types, form base, config form base, and confirm form base, all have three required methods. I'll highlight them here for awareness, and we will build them out in coming videos. The first required method is getFormID. This returns a string that is the unique ID of the form. The next is buildForm. This returns a form API array that defines each of the elements of the form. Remember that I mentioned that we need to declare your form render arrays in the correct place in code, or they do not have meaning to the other systems? This buildForm method is that correct place. The final required method is submitForm. This method is where you begin to do things with the data, like save the data to the database, send an email, or any number of other operations. Notice that the buildForm and submitForm methods are required, but technically speaking, the validateForm method, the method which prevents the form from being submitted if the data is not valid, is not actually required. I'll leave it up to you to determine whether or not that is a good default. Wow, epic effort from you in understanding the fundamentals of Drupal's Form API. We learned that there are three types of forms in Drupal: form base, config form base, and confirm form base. We learned that each form type has three required methods of getFormID, buildForm, and submitForm. We learned that forms are declared in render array format, returned in the buildForm method of the form type class that we extend. Well, this is enough theory for now. We'll begin coding a form in the next videos. Happy learning!